Okay. Glory be to God. Nehemiah chapter 1. Somebody say trouble. Ready? If you're there, say amen. Media team, ready for us? If you go through warfare and don't learn anything, you will repeat the last test. All right, thank you, Laney. That's Laney's point. Ready, media team?
From verse 1?
From verse 1. Go ahead.
The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. And it came to pass in the month Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and a certain men of Judah. And I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept, and mourned certain days, and fasted, and prayed before the God of heaven.
All right, stop right there. Jump to verse 2, chapter 2, sorry, from verse 1.
And it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of
Artaxerxes,
the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king.
Nehemiah was the king's cupbearer. All right, go ahead.
No, I had not been before time sad in his presence.
Okay.
Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and I said unto the king, let the king live forever.
All right, stop right there. Nehemiah was afraid because the cupbearer should not be sad in the presence of the king. Your countenance has to always be, yes. All right, sometimes your countenance can determine if you have an agenda against the king. So Nehemiah's assignment as the cup, anybody know what the cupbearer does? Apart from holding the king's cup? Taste. Why do they taste it? To make sure it's not poison. So that means Nehemiah's assignment every day was to test if there was poison. But we give God praise that, you know, the anointing on him, that even if there's poison in the cup, it has to change. All right? Amen. Continue, Matthew. And?
Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said unto the king, if it please the king.
If you look at the progression, when Nehemiah first got the news, he prayed. When he went before the king asked him, what is your request?
He prayed.
Sometimes it is dangerous to answer immediately. Because sometimes we don't know what we want. Right? So even if someone says to you, what do you want? Say to them, let me pray about it, and I'll give you an answer. Right? Because there are certain favors that only come once. There are certain dimensions of favor that only come once. So you have to be very careful how you are very strategic, or be very wise how you give an answer. All right? Continue, Matthew. Minister Matthew.
And I said unto the king, if it please the king,
yes,
and if thy servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchres, that I may build it. And the king said unto me, the queen also sitting by him.
It could have been a possibility that the queen by Artaxerxes was Esther. Right? Because in Esther's time, the king's name was also Artaxerxes. So it could be a possibility that the queen sitting beside him at that time was Esther.
God
has a way of setting up your own people in the place of relevance to favor you. All right, continue.
For how long shall thy journey be? And when wilt thou return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time.
Yes.
Moreover, I said unto the king, if it please the king, let letters be given me to the governors beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come into Judah. And a letter unto Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the palace, which appertained to the house, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall enter into. And the king granted me according to the good hand of my God upon me.
Okay, according to?
The good hand of my God upon me.
Say, Lord.
Lord.
Let your good hand.
Let your good hand.
In this month.
In this month.
Be upon me.
Be upon me.
To show me favor.
To show me favor.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
All right, we're going to be in the book of Nehemiah for a little while this month. There are a few things we want to visit, a few things we want to dive into. Okay? One of the first thing that we want to look at is that Nehemiah was one of the captives in that time. But being a captive, we realize that he got favor to be the king's cupbearer. Spoke about Daniel, that even though he wasn't born in Babylon, he received favor in Babylon. We spoke about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they received favor. So you don't have to be born in a place to receive favor there. So if somebody says to you that, you have to be over there to know how the place run. How things work for others might not be the same how things work for you. Are you getting that? Never, ever, 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 ever use someone's experience to determine what your experience will be like. Are you getting that? I'll give you a perfect example. Someone went to St. Vincent before me. When they went to St. Vincent before me, I think I gave it before, said it before. When they went there, things did not flow for them. And they came back and said to me, just like the 10 spies, and said, the land is not good. Nothing is working. Don't go expect anything. When I went there, different treatment. As a matter of fact, I even got to go back. You understand what I mean? So never allow somebody's experience, even if it's the same teller, that doesn't mean the same teller will be with you the same way. Are you getting me? Everybody has a different level of favor in their life. Everybody is carrying something that is different than everyone else. Are you with me? So never allow the experience of someone else to cause you to premeditate what your experience will be like. So Nehemiah was in a position where he had to stand beside the king every day to fulfill his assignment. Sometimes the place you are at currently is not a bad place to be. Because sometimes you are seated beside some people who are carrying the resources that you need. Are you getting me? But Nehemiah, I believe, at one point now got settled in his position as the king's cupbearer. And the Bible said that some men came to him and inquired of them, what is happening in the place that I came from? And they said, the people there are in affliction, the walls are torn down, and the gates are broken down. Immediately, Nehemiah got a burden. I will say this to you. If you don't have a burden for something, you will never pray about it. You will never stay in front of God's face about it. If you don't have a burden, when I mean a burden, I mean the bowels of compassion have been open, right? You go to your bed, you dream about it. You wake up, it is on your mind. Anybody ever encounter that? It's constantly on your mind, all right? And because of what Nehemiah heard, a burden came on him. Some of us, we are not receiving certain burdens because the right things are not being said to us. Some of us are not capturing what God wants to do in us because we're not getting the right information. So Nehemiah got this burden. And when he got this burden, the next thing he did was that he entered into prayer. If the burden you have doesn't bring you into prayer, check something. He brought him into prayer. Why? Because he understood where he was. It's not like he could just leave, you know, say, may I take leave and go do business. Where he was positioned, he was now under authority. And I'm going to show you something here. He was under authority. And when he prayed, he went back to the king. Notice he didn't say anything to the king before. But the king saw his countenance. The king saw something on him that caused the king to ask, what is wrong? The king what? Saw something. the king saw something. I said to you, I think some months ago concerning David, that there was somebody that saw what David was doing, and because they saw what David was doing, they recommended him to Saul. Are you getting me? So because the king saw his countenance, saw what was happening to him, and the king knew that Nehemiah was always pleasant before him, he said, what is happening to you? I know you are not sick. What is happening? It must be sorrow of heart. And then he began to explain and say, how can I be happy when where I live, where I was born, the place is torn down? Nothing is working. Everything is out of alignment. How can you be happy when you check certain aspects of your life and it is out of whack? Don't be satisfied with what is working. There are some things that are not yet working that you need to work on. And until you get a burden that this thing must change, this thing must work, this thing must come into alignment, you will be satisfied with what is working, and what is not working, you will leave it there. Please understand, the scripture we read earlier, 4, did Roberta read the part about that and the people had a mind to work? If Nehemiah did not show up, then those people who had the ability to work would still be sitting down. And it could be a possibility that these people, in their heart, they were saying, we need to rebuild, but none of them had the courage. Are you getting me? Let's start truth. Some of us, we want to do some stuff, but we are afraid. Especially afraid of failing. Business owners, entrepreneurs. Yeah. Yep. You agree? So the greatest enemy of an entrepreneur is what? Himself and fear. Right? So Nehemiah began to speak to the king. And notice how he addressed him. He said, O king. Live forever. If some of you say, you know, some general, you know, say, that thing you are going on, I want that thing, and that. How you speak in your moment of favor will determine if you actually get favor. Are you getting this? How you position yourself. Somebody comes here and say, how can I help you? Boy, you know, somebody just want to pay me a light bill. And immediately the person says, this one, the kind of favor I have to give them, they're not ready for it. Are you understanding that? Yes. That is why you need to make sure you work, you refine your brand. Hallelujah. Those who are at the Brand Me course, say amen.
Amen.
Yes, today I can say hallelujah. Yesterday I couldn't say it. All right? I was in professional mood, so I couldn't be on the platform saying, glory be to God, and all these things. So Nehemiah approached and he said, O king, live forever. Then he began to express. And for every point that the king asked him a question, he showed reverence. He showed honor. And then the king said to him, how long will you go? How long will you live? Do you see how the favor is coming? But Nehemiah didn't get familiar with the king. He kept his honor. He continued to acknowledge who was over him. Listen to me. Hear me very well. I have seen in many places, as soon as somebody get a door, they forget who was praying for them. They forget who was over them covering. Are you getting me? Even if God opens the entire world to you, never step out of that place in dishonor. Is that making sense? Is that making sense? If you're with me, we just wave your hand like this. All right? So he said, if it please the king, and if I have found favor in thy sight, verse 5 of Chapter 2, all right? If I found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me to Judah, unto the city of my father, the sepulchre, that I may build it. So Nehemiah was saying, even though I want to go, I need the king to send me. Because who sends you, cover you? You know, a bishop would say, some were sent, while some went. If it please the king, send me. That means if the king says you can now go, if anybody asks him, why are you leaving? He can say, the king sent me. Make sure if you are going somewhere, you are covered. Are you following me? Anything that you are doing, make sure that you are covered. That when you get to that place that should favor you, you are not there uncovered. There is nothing, you see, there are certain warfares I did not go through because I had spiritual covering. I still have. I know I use the word had. I still have. Right? There are certain warfares you will never go through if somebody is covering you. It's something I've lived. Check certain persons who are not covered. I've seen them. I've encountered them. The wife here is, you know, you cast out demon, you cast out demon, them cast out demon, them got them here, demon attack them. You cast out the same demon, you got your bed, you got your yard, you sleep. And you're wondering, why aren't you being attacked? Because there is something greater over you that is covering you. So spiritual covering is not just a matter of a pastor saying, you're my member. There is something even God honors in heaven. Are you getting me? So Nehemiah asked, send me to Judah that I may build it. So the assignment was that Nehemiah wanted to build. Now, he had the desire to build, but he did not have the resources. I think I said you can have the know-how, but don't have the resources. You can know what needs to be done, but you lack the... When you look at your cupboard and say, that needs to come down and it needs to put up, but when you check the bank account, you say, Father, the desire is there, the know-how is there, but the money... Can we testify to that, some of us? Yes. We know that we need to buy a new washing machine because the one we have going like this. But when we say, God, show me favor. When you check your account, you say, there is no favor. Are you getting me? So Nehemiah was in a position that he was able to pull resources from somebody who had unlimited resources. All because he was consistent in holding a cup. All because he was consistent in what? Holding a cup, drinking, holding a cup, drinking, countenance up, holding a cup, drinking. For the king to know that something is wrong in Nehemiah must mean that every day Nehemiah came to work, Nehemiah was happy. Nehemiah knew what needed to be done. Start bringing your emotions to work. Somebody say, mercy on us. Start bringing your what?
Emotions
to work. Are you getting me? Before you step through the door, go and step in. Are you understand what I'm saying to you? For the king to know that something was wrong with Nehemiah, sorry, Latimore, that must mean that Nehemiah was consistent to a point that even the king knew his mannerism when it's time for work. King! Cup! Are you getting me? So, all right. There are certain persons I know when something is off with them. I know when certain things are not flowing because I know their consistency. And the moment it falls, I know. May not have to ask them what happened. There are certain signs you see. As a pastor, there are certain signs you see. You know, some things are discernment. Yes, but there are some things that are just obvious. Are you getting me? If you pay attention to the people around you, you will know when something is off with them. Sometimes it's not a matter about, I was going to say, I thaw in the rails. So there's not a matter about that. Right? So because Nehemiah was consistent, the king saw him and the king said to him, what is happening to you? And he explained to him, I need favor to go and build. He now said, before you send me, now give me letters. Give me something that I can show that I am indeed sent by the king. Give me access to the men that have the lumber, the steel. Just write me a letter that where I am going, I will have the necessary word to access these things. All right, some of you just missed that. Give me the right words. So anywhere I am going, if I step into the bank and they say nobody can get any more loan, and you step there, there's, oh, we have to give it to you. Uh-huh. You understand me? Yeah. So the letter that Nehemiah would get, anywhere he took it within the province, as long as the king's seal is on it, he would have to get access. Are you getting that? Not only that, anything that the king, Artaxerxes, wrote could not be renounced.
Yes.
So Nehemiah literally had a letter. Oh, my God. Amen. The only thing that could cause it to end was the date on it. Imagine God giving you a pass with no date on it. Imagine God saying to you, favor for lifetime. Imagine God looking at you and say, every year of your life, you will change your car, change your car, change your car. Are you understanding me? There are people, you know, they are favored to an extent. But there are people, they walk in unlimited favor. Are you getting me?
But that favor is dependent on who writes your letter.
Are you understanding that? Are you following me? Are we going somewhere?
So Nehemiah got the letter. When he got the letter, the king now decided to release him. Now, when the king released him, the assignment was to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. That was the assignment. Now, there is something that Nehemiah did. We want to go into it. Thank you, Jesus. But before we go there, see in chapter 2, let's read verse 9. Let's see verse 9. Glory be to God. Yeah, chapter 2, verse 9. Discernment sharp, man.
Then I came to the governors beyond the river,
uh-huh,
and gave them the king's letters.
Uh-huh.
Now the king had sent captains of the army, uh-huh, and horsemen with me.
Okay, so Nehemiah who? Captains, the armies, horsemen, not only letter, but he had people to fight for him,
mm-hmm,
to defend him, to protect him. May God send people that will speak for you for good.
Amen.
In this month. May God cause people in high places to call your name, and those who want to move your name, may they continue to let your name be placed in favor. In Jesus' name. Continue, Minister Matthew.
When Sanballat the Horonite.
When Sanballat? Yes.
The Horonite.
The name Sanballat means strength. Continue.
And Tobiah the servant,
mm-hmm,
the Ammonite, heard of it grieved them exceedingly.
Now watch this. Sanballat means strength. Tobiah means, she's so strange. Tobiah means Jehovah is good.
Mm.
You know, some people can have some name but living contrary to the name, you know.
My God.
Continue.
Heard of it, grieved them exceedingly,
uh-huh,
that,
uh-huh,
there was come a man,
uh-huh,
to seek the welfare,
okay,
of the children of Israel.
Now, hear me, ladies and gentlemen. Best believe, the moment you decide in yourself that you are going to start to build, structure your family, fix your life, they are governors. They are people who have been living in that land. You over there, so? You over here. As long as you don't touch here, we are good. No trouble. Do you know that there are demons that operate that way?
Yeah.
As long as you don't trouble this, we are fine. If you stay over there, don't trouble the financial poverty in your people's family.
Yeah.
If you just stay and eat your mackerel and rice. Are you understanding me? As long as you don't go to school, as long as you don't try university, we are fine. Just go to primary school, drop out of high school, and live your life anyway. Don't try to become a graduate. Don't try to become a university student. As long as you don't trouble that, stay single. All right? Don't even try to get married. As long as you stay single, have as much baby mother as you want, baby father as you want. As long as you just stay. Once you stay in that realm, we are good.
Are you understanding that?
Okay. You don't see any opposition from Sanballat and Tobiah as long as Nehemiah stayed as a cupbearer.
Yeah.
So there are some people who are satisfied where you are satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
Are you understanding that?
Yes.
The moment you decide to say, God, give me a word for my family. The moment you decide to say something wrong, man, something needs to change. Best believe the governors at that region. And the men who were even governors, they're not even legitimate Jews. So there are people who are squatting in your destiny, and they don't belong there. Are you understanding me? Let's go further. Nehemiah came, a simple cupbearer, you know. He didn't have any stripes. He didn't have any.
I am he who was the Nehemiah that is to come. The ogre at the top.
Senior
Apostle.
Amen. Welcome to Kingdom Word, everybody. Right? Nehemiah, the cupbearers were just normal men. All you need to do is to drink and pass. Imagine somebody who nobody regards decides to step into something major and say, okay, nobody in the family wants to go to university, I will go.
Uh-huh.
And they will look at you and say, What are you trying to do? You know, make no sense. They're looking at your size and they're saying it is not possible because you don't fit the bill. Listen to me. God is not looking at how you look and your size. Uh-huh. He's looking at your height. Uh-huh. What? All right, let me show you something.
Go ahead, sir.
If some of you should ever understand the power of setting your height to seek something.
Oh, yes. Go ahead.
I'll give you a key for free. I'll give you a key. One of the ways how I grew in certain spiritual things is that I set my heart to seek it. Do you know that if you're going to go on fasting and you have not pastored your heart to do it, you will struggle in the fast? So you can have Allah 19. You start fast today, by 12 o'clock, flesh say, all right, time now, done. And all they try to push through, you're speaking tongues and still going in the fridge, go look. Holy Ghost! What time? Father, I break every power in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I wonder if Mummy Terry is in the order yet. No, you understand what I'm saying to you?
Yeah.
So you have to, don't worry, I'm going to do a teaching on it. I'm going to do a teaching on it called how to set your heart to certain things, all right? So Nehemiah decided to break out of the position that they set him, right? This happened because somebody said something to provoke him. Some of you will never move until somebody provoke you out of it. Some of you will never change until a person look at you and say, you know, say you're a joke with your life. Yeah. How old are you now? 25. You know, say you waste 10 years of your life already. Some of us will never move until we are embarrassed or hurt. Can I show you something? All right. Let me just give her a testimony, right? Let's give her not a testimony. I'm not giving no testimony. It's not a testimony, this. There are persons, right? As long as the relationship is going good, they are very... Little Charmaine, you all right? All right. Say, bless her, Lord.
Bless her, Lord.
Amen. All right. So, as long as certain things are going good, they're lazy, they lack a day sick, but as soon as fire lit them, as soon as somebody broke them heart, you see me? Me not date nobody again. I'm just building me. I'm focusing on me. Right now, I'm learning how to love me. You never know if I love you before. Am I lying? No, talk it truth and shame, devil man. Am I lying? You never know, say you're supposed to love yourself before that. Me, I'm staying away from relationships. Right now, I'm just focusing on becoming a better me. Oi, oi. Yeah, man, the juicy at the top. So Nehemiah, where was I? Where? Yes, thank you. Some of us are only moved when we are despised and rejected and people turn backs on us. You understand me? Some of us, we only become focused when we are now encountering pain. Are you getting that? If you are having a headache right now and this headache is beating you, your only concern is, I need to get rid of it. Even if church are going, you say, maybe a gas may have or something like that. You begin to question what is happening. You're not paying attention to anything else, you know, except that thing that is bothering you. Yeah, so pain can make people get focused? Okay. Please, don't let God pain you before he focuses you. My God! Don't let him what? Yes, 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 yes. I remember a man of God said, change before you are forced to. So Nehemiah, a cupbearer. I want you to understand that it is not, I will not even, I have some notes, I'm not even going to write it. I have not even touched the notes yet. So Nehemiah was just a simple cupbearer, and a simple man was ready to do a major thing. Are you getting me? Was Nehemiah qualified? Did any prophetic word come? Did anybody say, I see that you will raise Jerusalem? No. What brought him to that position was a burden. Just hearing about it. Huh? I know I can say about Vanjie Prof. She doesn't like poverty. She hates it to the core. If you want her to pray about something, you want her to pray with fire, just say, pray against the spirit of poverty. She will murder it, resurrect it, and murder it again. And you get that because she has a, when she looks at her family, there's a burden on her that me, my husband, my children to come. Listen, not even the word pee must be. Are you getting me? So if you don't have a burden, you will never move. Nehemiah got a burden, and this burden provoked him to pray. Then provoked him to ask. Then provoked him to pray. And after he was approved, he now began to move. Are you getting me? When he got the letter and he got there, the men that were governing the city, raiding the people, raping the people, squeezing the people, not building the people, bad politicians. Bag of promises, no manifestation. Glory be to God. Someone need to stay in the spirit, you know, because when I go somewhere else, this has nothing to do with that. All right? put a hex beside Jesus. Right? So when he got there, the spirits that be, Sir Latimore, Sanballat, Tobias, when they saw the letters, Minister Matthew, read it again for me, please.
When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it, grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of
Can
Israel.
I show you something? If you look at it, the life of the Israelites, you will always see some former Ammonites in there. With Jehoshaphat, Ammonites were there. With Gideon, Ammonites were there. So there are always some things that love to always continue themselves in your life. And if you are not careful to kill them all, they will regenerate. If they die, it goes into their children. If their children, it goes into their grand. Are you getting me? So there are some things you need to kill before it transfers. Are you with me? Read Matthew. Minister Matthew, sorry. And it grieved them.
So I came to Jerusalem.
No, read that part again. And it grieved
and
them.
And it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man.
That there was what?
Come a man.
Okay. That means they knew that nobody in the region was brave enough to challenge them. So when Nehemiah decided to step up, they knew that something was about to change. Because somebody decided to come and build. Are you getting me? Even though that demon doesn't want you to come over here, best believe he knows if you rise up, you will destroy and break what he's doing. Are you getting me? So he's pumping fear into you. He's pumping questions into you. And he knows if you should ever decide to get up and begin to confront this thing, he has no more power over it. You know why? Because the legal right is already yours. Are you getting me? They were grieved because a man, in this context, male and female. Somebody decided to leave their comfort zone. Somebody decided to leave standing. Nehemiah lived in the palace, you know. So Nehemiah could have walked and I say, I may have the cup, the king cup. I may have the cup, the king cup. I may have the cup, the king cup. No, I'm serious. Huh? Maybe check out Nehemiah's bedroom. I could have said, yo, if I saw the prisoner, then leave, brother. Sleep nice. Wake up. Nehemiah, yes, I come in. I may have the cup, the king cup. No, are you understand what I'm saying to you? Yeah. Nehemiah was comfortable, chilled, relaxed. You know me? You know if I'm standing up? Do you know where I work? I work at the right arm of the king. Yeah. You know what I hold? The king cup. Ram put me now. King cup. No, are you getting me? Nehemiah could have said, okay, Jerusalem is burnt down. That not enough to do with me. Me comfortable. Yeah, man. Like what Esther said, you know, maybe God or uncle had to say, okay, Tande, if you don't answer, God will raise up one to. Are you understand what I'm saying to you? Are we getting this? Nehemiah knew that he had a responsibility to where he came from. Some of you, instead of trying to cut off your family, you need to fix it. Yep. Instead of saying, me not fit deal with them, you better go look for them and say you're good. All right. I'm not telling you to be lovey-dovey, you know. I'm saying to you, as a spiritual man, you need to make sure certain lines are covered. Because you don't, anything you don't settle now, your children will come and have to fight it.
And me have the cup, the king cup. And I feel like somebody going to post that.
Nehemiah had to confront what was happening. And he decided, Bradley, to what? Get up, leave his comfort zone, and come into the place that was desolate. You see, some of you want to move from green grass to green grass to green grass. You don't want to find that, you don't want to find dry ground and test if you are really one farmer. You don't want to find broken people to see if you're really a repair of the breach. You want everybody that is whole, easy to work with. They understand the flow. What is leadership?
Influence. Okay.
Nehemiah, who was a cupbearer, had to now step into the position of what? Leadership. Nobody anointed him. All he had was a burden. And that burden gave him the right words. And he positioned him, even if the place did dry. He knew the assignment was to what? Build. How can I build if there's nothing to build? Some of you don't know that your skills would hide. Your skills will hide when there is nothing to do. Your value would not be seen if there's nothing to do. I'm a motivational coach, but everybody around is motivated. How will that help anybody? That's not the purpose. You're a farmer, but where you go green and flourishing and the tree grew by itself. Adam was not a farmer, you know. Adam was just taking care of the garden because everything in there grew by itself. Are you understand what I'm saying to you? Nehemiah decided to step into this place to build. Somebody say build. Somebody say build. Somebody say build.
Build.
Listen, when you leave this place today, I kid you not, you know. I kid you not. I have not even looked at my notes, I'll know. What I'm saying to you is just through the scriptures. I have not touched, not even the first line of my notes yet. When you leave here, make up in your mind, my children must not come and build what I should be building now.
Yes.
Make up in your mind,
yes.
2025 must not catch me building. I should, can I talk to somebody here? 2025 must not catch me still trying to find black and cement to cover this thing. I'm not talking about physical also. I'm talking about your personal life. The you that you are today. Best believe, you know, pastor is not perfect. And pastor slap upon some things. Are you getting me? I know where I am and I know what to do. Ask God to show you where you are. Because if you don't know where you are, you won't know where to go next. Is that an amen?
Amen.
Which verse today? Verse 9, go ahead.
No, sorry, verse 11.
Verse 11.
So I came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days.
Okay.
I arose.
Wait. The Bible is very, very intentional about certain things. We know that the number 3 means resurrection. Okay? So Nehemiah was there 3 days. Verse 12, go to Minister Matthew, read it for us. Let us see what's happening here.
And I arose in the night.
When?
And I arose in the night.
Okay. Continue.
I and some few men with me.
Who? He and who?
Some few men with me.
Some of you, too many people know your night dealings.
Yeah.
But continue.
Neither told I any man what my God had put in my heart.
Okay. Shut your mouth until the time.
Kiba.
Are you getting me? There must be only few men. Few men. I mean, not that people who only hear, I don't know if you know. There must be only few men. Are you following me? Mm-hmm. You don't need everybody. And when I say that, I mean, I say you must cut off everybody. I'm saying to you, in certain seasons of your life, you must know who and who to talk to. See, baby Saint, agree with me. Getting that? Neither told any man what my God put in my heart. So watch this. Even the men that were around Nehemiah didn't know what God put in Nehemiah's heart. Read Matthew.
Neither was there any beast with me, save the beast that I rode upon. And I went out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, and to the dung port, and viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and the gates thereof were consumed with fire.
Watch this. What did Nehemiah do in the night?
Survey.
Scan. Check it. Some of you don't know what is called spiritual mapping.
Intelligence gathering.
God. I'll give you a true story. I went to a country, Guyana. And I went to Guyana for 3 weeks. Stayed in a 3-bedroom house, but the food hot. Jesus. The pepper. They gave me some rice that looked very colorful. When I bite it, I didn't realize all of it is pepper. So you know who was on fasting? Everything is pepper. So we're there, 3-bedroom. You know, I made one of the rooms a prayer room. And when we got there, you know, the person, I'm saying to myself, immediately in my head, I say, all right, do what Nehemiah did. Just chill. One day I was walking on the road, prophetess, and I heard someone go, I began to walk in the road. Because I don't know what is in the, they don't have sidewalk where we were. And where we live, they call it diamond. And you have diamond inside and diamond inside. And your accent would determine how much they charge you to take you home. Oh, Lord. So when you go there, you have to be trying to talk some Guyanese citizens. So that's how I end up with the biting. You know, Safia can relate to it. Where are you from? Just out of town, boy. China little thing, you know. It never work, but amen. So the person next door in the other room was constantly, you know, I bind every power, strong man in this region. And I'm there and saying, but how I prayed, I went into the room and you would not know that I'm in there. Very quiet. Not many days hence, the person ended up getting delivered. Just one person's wake up and start vomit. Deliverance. Then get attacked. You cannot go into a region. It doesn't matter what 90 you are. It is dangerous to go into a region and say, I am here. Die! And you don't know the powers that are working in that place. You don't know the spirits. You don't even know if they are staying on an altar today. Hey! Are you getting me? That is why my law, and I will say this to anyone that does ministry, as soon as you start to travel, even if you go outside your stay, turn your yard until ministry done. If ministry is from Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, turn your yard. Are you getting me? Stay at home. Don't be up and down all over the place. Stay at home. Okay? So for all those who will soon travel and do ministry, and the upcoming travelers, turn out no
yard.
Glory be to God. So Nehemiah surveyed and he realized what was happening. The city is burnt, the gates are burnt, everything is happening. You need to spend time to scan what is happening in your family. Spend time to see what is happening. Spend time to observe. You know, look at some stuff and say, okay, I see that this and this is happening at this particular time. Learn the patterns. If Satan is taking time to learn your pattern, you need to take time to learn the patterns of what is working against you. Don't be in a rush to cast out a demon and then end up being possessed by the same demon. Are you with me? Are you with me?
Amen.
So even if you have praying power, make sure the Lord releases you to pray. Okay, you don't want to pray and then become a prayer.
Hallelujah.
Continue, Matthew. Minister Matthew, sorry. I'm a son, you know, so sorry.
Then I went unto the gate of the fountain and to the king's pool. But there was no place for the beast that was under me to pass. Then went I up in the night by the brook and viewed the wall and turned back.
Verse 14, media team, thank you. Continue.
And entered by the gate of the valley.
Yes.
And so returned.
Yes.
And the rulers knew not whither
yes.
I went.
Yes.
Or what I did.
Yes.
Neither had I as yet told it to the Jews.
Yes.
Nor to the priests.
Yes.
Nor to the nobles.
Yes.
Nor to the rulers.
Yes.
Nor to the rest that
yes.
did the work.
Uh-huh.
Then said I unto them,
uh-huh.
ye see the distress that we are in,
uh-huh.
how Jerusalem lieth waste,
uh-huh.
and the gates thereof are burned with fire.
Uh-huh.
Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach.
Stop it. So that means the fact that the walls were down, it caused Israel to be in reproach. What is currently down in your life that is causing problem for you? Which wall of your life is currently down that is giving the enemy easy access? Which wall of your life is down that people can be talking things about you? We have to become conscious of certain things. Are you getting me? Nehemiah saw everything that was happening, and then he said to them, come, let us build. What did he say to them? Come, let us what? Build up the what? The walls. Walls speak to security. It speaks to defense. It speaks to being protected from outside forces. Come, it didn't say come let us drink. It didn't say come let us eat. There must be a season of your life that is called, this is my working season. This is my building season. This is my season to correct certain errors. You cannot set certain things in order if you yourself don't even know what is out of order in your life. There are some people, they don't live with direction, you know. They just live with the wind. Anyway, the wind carry them. You know, today I feel like bald my head. Today I feel like putting wig. There's no... You know what I'm saying? Today I feel like. You need direction in your life. And Nehemiah had a clear direction. We need to build. We need to what?
Build.
Say neighbor.
Neighbor.
You need to build.
Need to build.
Say neighbor.
Neighbor.
You need
need.
A clear direction.
Clear.
And the clear direction is?
Clear direction.
You need to build.
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 Come
to the minister, Matthew. Are you following me? Is this making sense?
Yes.
Are we traveling together?
Yes.
All right. Verse 18. Read, Minister Matthew. Read.
Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me.
Yes.
As also the king's words that he had spoken unto me.
Yes.
And they said, let us rise up and build.
Uh-huh.
So they strengthened their hands for this good work.
Oh my God.
But when
Wait. And they strength. Go back, please, to verse 18. You see, there's a time in your life where you need people that would buy into your vision and buy into your brand and buy into your building. He told them, firstly, of the favor that God showed him. Secondly, of the favor that the king gave him. You see, if somebody came to me and said to me, you know, say, such man has given me this amount of land. We need to build something. Best believe, there are some persons, because you have land, they will say, I will buy steel. I will get block. What do you need? If you don't have anything, if you don't have any canvas, any blank canvas, there are some people that cannot help you because you have nothing for them to work with. Are you with me? I guess it is TV is here. Sorry. Told him the king that he had spoken unto me, and they said, let us rise up
and build.
So they strengthened
their hands for this good work.
How do you strengthen your hands? They strengthened their hands. That means mentally they prepared themselves. Emotionally they saw the bigger picture. That anything we're going to do, there's going to be sacrifice. There's going to be warfare. There's going to be resistance. But we are strengthening our hands for this good work. They never said they're strengthening their hand for any bad work. He said this good work, based on what Nehemiah explained to them when he said, the good hand of the Lord is upon me. If the good hand of the Lord is upon me, it means that God wants to do a good work. They strengthened their hands for the good work. Oh my God. I wish somebody would get this. Listen, there is a good work in your life, you know. And God is going to send people to strengthen their hands to be a blessing to you. God is going to send people to look at the good hand of God upon your life. Look at the favor you are receiving and say, let us join together with you. Let us come in agreement with you. What do you need us to do? They strengthen their hands. You know, listen, you know who was Nehemiah's greatest asset? Not Sambalat and Tobiah. The men that needed help. The men that were busted. The men that have been waiting for someone. Come and help them. Huh? The Bible said when David went into the cave called Adullam, men were in there that were busted. Now have no hope. And David, who was running, had to become a hope for people. Listen to me. Sometimes you need to, I'm not saying this to just, you know, to be inconsiderate. But sometimes, even though you're going through hell, you have to forget your hell to help somebody else. Are you understand what I'm saying to you? Sometimes you have to forget the fire that is burning around you and be like this. You're out in somebody else's fire while your fire is still burning. You don't know art in time that by helping somebody, God helps you. Some of us don't know that. The Bible said after Job prayed for his friends, that is when God delivered him. So stop saying, God help me. No. When was the last time you prayed for somebody? When was the last time you took out a list and said, God, I'm praying for these people for the rest of this month? You don't know that oftentimes your breakthrough is connected in helping somebody's breakthrough. Are you getting what I'm saying to you here? It is not because, listen to me, it's not because you are entitled to anything. Sometimes that is just how God works. Many of you have been praying and you're saying, God, remember my bills. And God said, stop praying for your bills and pray for somebody else. It shifts your prayer that you start praying for everybody else except yourself. And you feel as if God doesn't remember you. He remembers you. But God is using your obedience to pray for others so that he can settle your matter. Oftentimes, what you are praying about, God has already dealt with it. So why should you pray about it? Huh? Songbird? Are you understanding what I'm saying to you? Oftentimes, you are. Okay, I'll be very honest with you about something. I hardly pray for myself, you know. Very hardly. If this is what, 2024? 2024, right? Okay. If I say to you that I've prayed for clothes once in the last 2 years, I'll be lying to you. I don't pray for myself. I don't pray for God, I need clothes. God, I need this. Lord, send Baril. Send fridge, God. I don't. You know what I do? The Bible say, you have my because you what? So I say, God, I need a fridge, you know. Really need a fridge, you know. There's some of us. There is a realm you can get to in God. You think it and it comes. I'll share something with you. Lady Diane came today. She brought something nice. And I received. She didn't know that it was yesterday I was thinking about another one. I didn't say, I command. We love that. We love to pray that way. Are you getting me? All right. If you realize in our prayer meetings, do you realize that most of the time we normally pray for ourselves last in our prayer meetings? Do you realize that? Okay. Is there a reason why? If you put somebody else's need before yours, God honors it. Can you imagine being on one day and you have the last mackerel? And God say, take it and go on the road. Give it to, I say, Satan, I bind you. And all your spirit, I want to teeth this last mackerel, you know. Eh? I'm going to eat it. I'm hungry. And God said, give it away. Yeah, your boss fear. You see, if we should, my wife and myself should share some testimonies with you, you know. If we should share some, you know. I can't share it. Can't share it, right? Can't share it. Think we can share it. I'll just speak in code. Right? So somebody I know had a bill to be paid, right? And the person was so concerned how the bill is going to be paid, they didn't start to get stressed about the bill, right? So somebody called him and said, why not call your son and say X, Y, Z, yada, yada, yada. The person didn't want to bother disturb their son. So when now the son heard the matter and called the individual and said, what is it? Got the amount? Said, just that. So immediately somebody came to the son's mind to call. So when he called that person, the person said, I was waiting on you to call me to get a confirmation because there's a certain amount of money I want to give to you. So if that person wasn't called by that person, then that person would have called that person, then that person would have said, I have over such and such amount of money if you give you. And that person who was concerned about the little money got more than 10% or more. Five times the amount. All right. I'll give you an example. Let's say the person wants $400 and the person end up getting $1,500. US. One time. What is also interesting, the bank that the person used is 10 minutes away from the person who had the money. So they went there, lodged it. But the person who is supposed to get the money, that the person was supposed to get the money, you know what they did? They gave the money to the person that needed it. Somebody ain't not getting what I'm trying to say to you, you know. You don't want to give away a little $500 and say, God, have somebody want to give you $1 million. Yeah. Eh? Yes. You don't want to give up so you can go up. Wow. Let it go. Huh? Somebody say, Lord, show us favor. Mm-hmm. All right. Where are we? This good work. Amen. Minister Matthew, come. Somebody else. The Lord give you strength to be healed today, in Jesus' name. Glory be to God. Verse 19. Let's take your time.
Then answered I them and said unto them, uh-huh. The God of heaven.
No, verse 19.
But when Sanballat,
uh-huh.
The Horonite,
uh-huh.
And Tobiah the servant,
uh-huh.
The Ammonite,
uh-huh.
And the Geshem,
watch this
the
now.
Arabian.
Somebody else is now present. So first it was Sanballat, then Tobiah, no, somebody named Geshem joined the party. We don't even know where these people are coming from. All right, Geshem means rain. Continue.
The Arabian heard it, uh-huh. They laughed us to scorn and despised us,
mm-hmm.
And said, what is this thing that ye do?
Mm-hmm.
Will ye rebel against the king?
Mm-hmm.
Then answered I them and said unto them.
So these men came face to face with Nehemiah. Some of you, when you are confronted, you more change. You are bold in private. Me, I would stop. But when they come, I draw me that my man. Me, you know, I'm not a serious man. I'm just a, huh? These are governors, you know, that came before Nehemiah, you know. And they said, listen to me, you are doing something. Do you plan to rebel against the king? They did not know that Nehemiah was fully armed. You see, listen to me, people must not know what you are carrying. Mm. Let some people talk.
Yes.
Let them run their mouth and say, who do you think you are? And they don't even know that you have the big CEO tag. Let some people look at your simplicity and talk and run their mouth. They will have to apologize later. Read from verse 19 again. Let us get it.
But when Sanballat the Horonite,
uh-huh.
And Tobiah the servant,
uh-huh.
The Ammonite, and the Geshem the
and
Arabian,
Geshem. Yes.
Heard it, uh-huh. They laughed us to scorn and
my
despised
God.
Us
uh-huh.
And said, what is this thing
uh-huh.
That ye do?
Uh-huh.
Will ye rebel against the king?
So they had no idea that Nehemiah was sent by the king. They had no idea that something was backing him. They had no idea that he was not there of his own will, but he was there on divine assignment. He had no idea that the entire king, because if the king is backing you, the kingdom has to back you. Mm. Are you getting me?
Yes.
If the king is backing you, then the resources are also there for you.
Yes.
So Nehemiah never had to say, you know what me I carry? He never had to ask. Listen to me. When you know what you have, you don't argue with people.
Yes.
When you know what you are carrying, you don't try to prove anything to anybody. The people that try to prove something to somebody are people who are insecure. Read it. Then I answered them.
Then answered I them and said unto them, the God of heaven,
the God of heaven,
he will prosper us.
My God.
Therefore, we his servants will arise and build. But ye have no portion, nor right, nor memorial in Jerusalem.
Watch this. Watch this. Watch this.
Go my ahead.
God. He says, we. Who is around? Who is in your circle right now? That you can say, we. But we is not people from outside he went for, you know. Listen to me. Stop trying to find people from outside who don't understand what is happening inside. Get some people who are fed up of their situation, fed up of what they are going through. Get some people who say, I am tired of poverty. Get some people who are hungry enough. Get some people who are thirsty enough that when you say to them, yo, it's time for Bill, they will say, we're ready long time. You don't know who is waiting on you to say something so that they can do something. There are people who are workers, but they need people who are activators. Some people can't talk because they're not designed to talk. They were designed to work. They were designed to follow. But if you are the one who's the activator, that has the key in your mouth to get them moving, as long as you keep your mouth shut, the machine will never turn on. Are you getting me? Are you getting me? If Jesus did not show up where Peter and Andrew was and said to them, follow me and I will make you, they would have died fishermen. They would not have become apostles. They would have died ordinary men. They would be ordinary like their father. But when Jesus stepped in and saw them and said, this man is catching fish in the natural, but in the spirit, he's a fisher of men. Let me bring him into his reality. And he said, follow me and I will make you. Somebody is waiting to hear your word so they will know where to go. Somebody is waiting to hear a direction so they will know what to do. Stop waiting for people to talk when God has given you the word already. Stop waiting for somebody to tell you what to do when you went into prayer and God said, get up and go by you. Get up and go to the bank. There are people who are waiting for you to say something so that they can move something. There are people who have the ability to do the work, but they need somebody to lead them, to direct them, to order them. They have all the money, but they don't know where to spend it. Are you following me? If you're with me, say amen.
Amen.
Nehemiah had to go down there and say, ready for Bill. And these men were waiting for somebody to say. They were saying, we live in this place. God did not send us here for no reason. We live here, and because we live here, we understand what's happening. And we are the ones that we're designed to build. Do you know that the best person sometimes to work with is the person who understands the situation? They won't take it for granted. Sometimes people don't know, you know, they say, they don't know. They might not understand. But you're not going to understand until you feel the lick from me I get. Are you getting me? Nehemiah was an activator. An activator. Nehemiah left, and I'll say it again, his comfort zone. Went down into a place that was destroyed. Went down to somewhere that was governed by people who were not Jews. People who had stepped into power because they began to mix and mingle with the Israelites. But Nehemiah was not perturbed because the word of the king was greater than the word of the governors. So I look at demon, I try to discourage you. Whose word do you have? They're telling you it is not working. Whose word do you have? It didn't come true this time. It doesn't mean it will never come true. Disappointment doesn't mean it will never work. Amen. Setback doesn't mean you won't get to come back.
Amen.
Stop allowing. You see, I understand, you know. I said, God, I believe you by faith it will work. And when you go there, it won't work. That doesn't mean it won't work. Sometimes God will pull you back to see if you will keep your faith. Even after being, listen, what if God closed that door that should have been the best door for you? Would you still praise him? You get 10,000 prophecy. The door is opening and God says, all right, let me see something. And go. Eh? Pastor, do you know? Me that pray for this, Pastor. Pastor, I just feel so disappointed. I just feel so broken. And I'm just feeling emotional. I don't know what to do. I don't feel like even praying anymore. God will do to you what he did to Apostle Gardner and say, Kuyo. Huh? If none of your prophetic words ever come to pass, will you still serve God? Stop living conditional Christianity. Huh? If he does it, I will praise him. If he doesn't do it, you're going into depression. What kind of Christianity is that? Eh? So your walk with God is dependent on if he does it or he doesn't do it. Hmm? Let me do it again. Yes, we will arise and build. Yet, you have no portion.
Nor right, nor memorial in Jerusalem.
You have no portion. The word portion there means you have no part, no territory, no share. So these men, what Nehemiah was about to do was about to kick them out of power. Sometimes you don't know what you are building that will break the back of certain things in your family. You don't know that the building you are building is causing certain spirits to lose their right. Listen to me. If the spirit is called poverty, if there is wealth, he has no power where wealth is. He has to only stand where poverty is. You're not getting it. If the spirit only has power when there is poverty, when you become a millionaire, how can he strive if his power is tied to poverty?
Yes, go ahead.
So if you break poverty, he has no power. Are you getting this?
Yes.
So you are praying, break. Poverty, break. And you have not yet read a book. You have not yet started a business. You are not trying to make money. But you are saying, poverty, break. And poverty is looking at you and say, me back too strong. Oh. I cannot break. Oh. There are some things that you get delivered from when you start to do certain things. And everything is not every deliverance comes by prayer. You have no territory, no part, no right. And what's interesting, the number for right here is 6666. You have no part, you have no right. The number is 6666. The number 6 means man. 66 means idol. And 666 means antichrist. I won't tell you another 6 mean, but I know homework. So he was. My God. All right. Let me not go into that here because I might cause more problem. No memorial, no remembrance, no reminder in Jerusalem. So Nehemiah was saying, what I'm about to do, any right you had before, any connection you had before, because a genuine one is here, you have no right. Even Nehemiah knew that these men did not belong in this territory. Have you ever scanned your life and see the things that do not belong there? The things that should not be functioning there? The people who are in and out of your life that should not be there? Listen to me. Sometimes the people who you attract is not the people you were designed to see, but it's because your forefathers did not close that door to those people. Their ancestors find themselves in your life. So the people who you are encountering is not because of what you have done. It's because of what your forefathers refused to shut. Because the children of Israel began to mix and mingle, they received governors that were not of their kind. And these governors began to rule over them just as though the Egyptians were ruling over them. Listen to me. It was not
the same country, but it was the same repeat. I don't know who is in this house today that you are seeing the pattern of your mother in your life. You are seeing the pattern of your father in your life. You are seeing the story. Everybody is saying nobody gets big. Nobody becomes relevant. Everybody's either smoking weed or doing this. Today I came to prophesy that anyone in your life that does not belong here, just as old Nehemiah said, you will have no portion, you will have no right, and you will have no memorial in my life. When I begin to build, you will no longer be remembered what you have been holding on to. When I begin to build, it is about to be broken out of your hand, what you took from my great grandmother. When I begin to build, it's about to come back into my hand. I wonder, there is a Nehemiah that you've got a burden in your spirit. The devil has been breaking some things, changing some things, but the Lord is raising you up by a holy anger, by a divine burden. They said nobody will change it, but I see an anointing coming upon somebody in this house, and it's called the anointing of Abin. I don't care how long it has been happening, the story is about to change. My God, the story is about to change. The story is about to change. Your bloodline has been waiting for you, but the Sanballat and Tobiah wants to keep you bound. But I heard the Lord say that this time it's about to change. I don't need everybody, but I need some Nehemiahs. When you look at your bloodline, when you look in your family, when you look at your children, when you look at your account, you are saying, God, my prophetic word does not line up with this. Something is wrong. A change needs to come. A yoke needs to be broken. Do I have about 10 people here that will say, Lord, I'm sick, I'm tired of being sick, I'm tired. The Sanballat in my bloodline, the Tobiah in my bloodline, it is no time for me to arise and begin to build.
It's no time. He said, you have no lot and part. You have no lot and part. Matthew, go to chapter 3. I want to show you something. I'm going to show you where you must start building from. Chapter 3, verse 1. Listen, you see, today, I don't need everybody, you know. I just need people who are tired of what they've been seeing. Huh? What should take you 3 months is taking you 2 years? Huh? The devil is a liar. Read it. Read it, Matthew.
Then Eliashib, the high priest, rose up with his brethren, the priests, and they builded the sheep gate.
All right, watch this. Eliashib means God restores. That's what his name means. God restores. Eliashib is the high priest. And the high priest is the one that must go into the place of prayer. The high priest is the one that is designed to pray. As a matter of fact, he's what he operates in what you call priesthood. That means the first place you begin to build is not in the place of complaint and suspicion. You begin to build in the place of prayer. You, my God, you bring your family before God. You bring your bloodline before God. And you say, Lord, any pattern that has been in my bloodline, I come as a priest of this bloodline. I come as a man of God of this bloodline. I come as the woman of God in this bloodline, and I decree and I declare, anything that has been fighting me, any Sanballat spirit, any Geshem spirit, any spirit of lack and poverty, as I begin to enter into prayer, oh Lord God, give me the king's favor, give me the king's word, let me begin to prosper, that poverty will begin to be broken. You've got to enter into prayer. Not only that, the Bible said he took his brethren, the priest. You need to find people who are of like mindset. You need to find people when it's prayer time, it's prayer time.
Shagabasanda. When it's worth your time, it's worth your time. I don't need people that when I call you, you're too tired. When I call you, you're too busy. You are not serious about your destiny. You need somebody that will say, you call me because I feel like a turn is about to happen. The Bible said that they built the sheep gate and they sanctified it. The word sanctified means to dedicate, to give back to. The next thing you need to do is to get the name of your bloodline and begin to sanctify them back to the Lord. Whatever sin they committed, by reason of the blood, I sanctify the Browns family. By reason of the blood, I sanctify the Latimore family. By reason of the blood, I sanctify the Lawrence family. Whatever they did 2,000 years ago, I implored that we were bought back, that we were redeemed by the blood. Is there anybody here? You are ready to go into the realms of the spirit and fight for your family. Enough is enough. Enough is enough. My story must change. My family must change. My life must change. What God has designed for me, it must come into my life. Somebody say, it's time to build.
They sanctified and set up the doors of it. It means that the gates had no door. So people could go in and out as they choose. You know why you need a door?
Yes.
To keep certain people out.
Yes.
And keep certain things in. There is nobody that has a treasure place and leave that place open. The door is to keep the thieves out and keep the treasure in. Somebody missed it. The door is to keep the thief out and keep the treasure in. You need to begin to put some doors around your life.
Yes.
To guide the treasure in you.
Yes.
You need to begin to build some doors that when God has given you access to something, you must secure that thing by divine doors. You must say, God, as you sent a sword in my garden Eden that turned everywhere, as you have downloaded to me this vision, anything that wants to affect it, I command the doors of fire to be around my life. I command the doors of lightning to be around my life. They began to build doors. If there are no doors there, Ingram, anybody can come in, take up things and leave. Huh? Some of you, you know that devil has been robbing from your life. Because every time you're supposed to get a breakthrough, it is given to somebody else. Every time you're supposed to walk into something, somebody else gets it. You know why? Because somebody keeps on stepping into your treasury and taking out your goods. Sanctified it. Even unto the tower of Mia, they sanctified it. Unto the tower of Ananiel. Ananiel means God has favored. So Eliashib means God restored. God restores. My God. Then the tower of Mia. Mia means 100. It means 100. So we're talking about 100-fold. God will restore 100-fold. God will restore 100-fold because God has favored you. God, somebody not getting it, you know. God will restore 100-fold. 100-fold means a completeness. God has restored 100-fold because he has favored you. I won't even go any further. Come in, I want to give everything. Next week, we're going to go to the next year. It's time to build. But you can't build if you're comfortable. It's time to build. It's time to build. Who are you allowing to reign in your life? Huh? Who are you allowing to take from your life? Who has set up an evil government over you? And say,
it is ours, Afibi.
You're a liar. You're a squatter. You need to come out. The land you are building on, you have no part in it. It's mine. The promise that God gave to me that my family will not suffer. My family will not be in lack. That my children and my children's children will only walk in favor and wealth. But when I check my life, certain things are out of order. You need to get up and start to build, restructure, reorganize, set again in motion. But you start by the place that is called prayer. Let us stand, everybody. We're going to pray. Today, we don't have music. We don't need it. Because today is a building day. Something must break. We're going to pray. Tell Sister Cooper Muminikisha to come inside. Yes. Let the tablet stay. You can take the Bible. I said it before, you know. AC you no want, AC you no get. Please chill now, right? Amen. This is the prayer we are praying. Lord, give me favor to build.
Give me favor to build.
Say, Lord.
Lord.
Any spirit. That has been robbing my life.
Any Sanballat.
Any Tobiah.
Any Geshem spirit.
That has been robbing from my life.
Say, Lord God.
Today.
Favor me.
To build.
Say, today.
Remove.
Anything in my life
that should not be there.
Remove any power that is contained in my life.
Say, oh Lord God,
as I begin to pray today,
send destiny helpers,
send builders,
send activators,
send people
who are designed
to pour into my vision,
to pour into my life.
Say, oh Lord,
as I begin to lift up prayer,
let my prayer be answered.
Let my prayer be answered.
Come on, lift your voice and begin to pray.
Begin to pray.
Sheka pasubra gabaski pelebanda
zebeketepe
ya papa la
shapada gadada baswa.
Wherever you are online,
begin to pray.
Zotegelebe katala basubra kanderebe sotoa
lepa basabrada.
If you're an usher,
make sure you pray with your eyes open.
Lebe kotorebo sonderebe kanda
epa ya panderebe sanderuba
iparopoa
ipravapoa
azomereke palazumba.
Come on, Nehemiah.
Building prayer.
Whatever
walls were torn down,
whatever the enemy torn down,
whatever they burn in fire,
the Lord is sending you
in the realms of the spirit
to rebuild.
Rambalagadalapavada,
epelepadakwata,
epalagwasanda.
Pray, Matthew, pray.
Zabako peleba,
epayala badala basandrebekwa.
Apawa,
epelebada,
epelebadwa.
Zabra papawa,
epepampara
bamba, epepopowa.
Itumba
ida kaida brande,
epaida kota
ramanda.
Izaibra pende.
Epelebe gadala gadala,
epayabala payabala,
epayabala bandarbia.
Somebody's digging.
Ozumba
rapawa,
epaba kopoa,
alezandere.
Whatever they burn with fire.
Opula
bazandere kopaya,
epayabawa.
Power.
I declare,
I must build.
Yeah,
like
the higher, separatoria, whatever pattern is set in your bloodline by reason of prayer, pray. In the name of Jesus Christ.